If you face blindness and it starts to seem as though your eyes are only good for crying and you're feeling all alone, come to a place of kindness and in a new way you will see that there's much more to hope than just learning to cope. You can live a life that's full and free. We're the Vision Resource Center. Let us be your guiding light as we strive to keep your dreams alive. Even if you lose your sight, you're not alone. Pick up the phone. We help friends and family too. We're the Vision Resource Center for people affected by blindness and low vision. We're here for you.
Insight on BCTV is supported by the Vision Resource Center.
Good morning and welcome to the January 2020 edition of Insight here on BCTV. I'd like to welcome our viewers and thank you for joining us. My name is Mark Levengood. I'm the counselor at the Vision Resource Center and we have a special show for you today. I am joined to my left by the president and CEO at Vision Resource Center, Lori Schermerhorn. And today she will actually be interviewing me regarding common questions that the sighted community often has for the visually impaired community, but the questions go unasked either because of a fear of being offensive or they just never have an opportunity. So today we're going to address as many of those questions as we can. So good morning, Lori. How are you?
Good morning. I'm good. How are you?
Excellent. So I'll hand the show over to you.
All right. Well, then let's jump right in. Could you explain about your vision loss, what happened and when?
Yeah. So back in February of 2003, almost coming up on 17 years, I was diagnosed with a brain tumor. And I was taken into the OR for biopsy brain tumor surgery. And when I entered the OR, I had vision. And when I woke up, it was total blindness. And so for me, it was total and instant, all at one shot. So.
Okay. And what was your initial reaction when you lost your vision? Were you scared or what were the emotions?
I would say a lot of shock, more so than fear. I don't really remember fear or being scared, but just shock. I mean, you know, with any surgical procedure, you're going to have potential risks or side effects. Certainly this procedure was no different. And we knew going in vision loss was a risk. But I would say the shock factor came in the sense that I'm the first blind or visually impaired person my family ever knew. So everything was new to us. We were learning every day for several years. So I would say more the shock value. Mm-hmm. But for the majority of visually impaired people, especially those with a slow degenerative condition, I would say that there is a level of fear. You know, every night they go to bed, if they have partial vision, they go to bed and think, is this it? Will I be able to see when I wake up tomorrow? You know, how quickly is this going to deteriorate? And then it's, of course, all the what ifs. What do I do when? How will I react if? What will it be like? How do I handle? You know, all those speculative questions that they can't answer that can often create a sense of fear for people that are losing their vision in that slow degenerative way.
Sure, like the fear of the unknown.
Exactly. Yep.
So you did say that you are completely blind. Mm-hmm. So what do you see? And is this the same for all visually impaired people or, you know, what about those who are blind from birth?
So the way I always describe it to people, my field of vision is when I had vision and would close my eyes, that's what it's like for me all the time. Eyes open or closed, it's like I have, it's like that time when I had vision and would close my eyes. That's 24/7 for me. I speculate that's what it's like for people who are blind from birth. I think it's difficult for them to communicate, though, to us because concepts or words like dark or black are totally, you know, like they don't know what that means. They don't know dark versus light. They don't know black versus not black. So for me, it's not total darkness. It's not total black, but at the same time, it is total blindness. I don't have any light perception. I could stare into the sun and not know it except for the warmth on my face. Now, for the visually, for the majority of the visually impaired community, that is not the case. You know, people with macular degeneration, which is the leading cause of blindness in the Western Hemisphere, they lose their central vision and they maintain, even at its most developed stages, people with macular, you know, they maintain their peripheral. On the other hand, people with retinitis pigmentosa, they lose the peripheral and they keep the central, but theirs just keeps progressing until they eventually reach total blindness as well. So, but the majority of the visually impaired community can see something, even if it is just light perception.
Okay. What about your other senses? Have they improved? You know, we always hear that if you lose one sense, your others take over.
Right.
Is that the case?
That is the case, but I will correct a common misconception that even I had. I would say that my senses are not stronger, but I use them to a greater potential and to the fullest level of their abilities. So at this point, I see the world through my ears and through my fingers. So I would not say that when I lost my vision, my hearing and sense of touch got better. It's just that I use them to a greater potential. So I hear things that a lot of people with sight don't because their sense of sight drowns out the noise because they see what I have to hear. So I'm using my ears to that greater potential, if that makes sense. But, you know, coming off the holidays and all the delicious holiday food, unfortunately, I can tell you my sense of taste is not better. I wish it was. But nonetheless, yeah, that's how I would say I'm using it to the greater potential.
So now you had sight and you lost it.
Right.
So do you remember what you look like or do you have an idea of what you look like now?
So I remember what I looked like at 13. You know, I was 13 years old and in the eighth grade when I lost my vision. It was a month before my 14th birthday. I remember what I looked like as an eighth grader. Not so much what I look like now. You know, I'm told what I look like, but it doesn't really mean anything. And to give everyone an idea of really to capture what this is like, this is going to sound comical, but a few years ago, I let my beard grow in. And because of the fact that I can't see in the mirror, I would forget that I had a beard for several months. So when I would wash my face in the morning or when I would touch my face if I had an itch or something and I felt hair, it surprised me because I would forget, oh my gosh, that's my face. I know that sounds funny, but I wasn't shaving anymore and yet I forgot that I had a beard because I wasn't looking in the mirror and I forgot what I was looking like each day.
So along the same lines, what about the faces of your family members?
Yes, I do remember them, but the thing is, I remember them from, again, 2003. So the running joke in the family is my parents will never have gray hair. My parents are getting ready in a couple months to take a trip to Israel, and my dad had to fill out the paperwork for his passport. And he asked my mom about his hair color, and when they agreed gray, I looked at my mom and said, that's weird. Like, to me, he will always have brown hair. Mom will always have light brown hair. Their hair will never be gray. But that also goes on the other side, too. I have a cousin who is a year younger than me, so when I lost my vision, she was 12, braces and glasses, and that's how I remember her. And in a couple months, she'll be 30. She's been married for a few years, and her husband just had a beautiful little girl. And so she says to me, Mark, you gotta lose that image.
So So we're staying along with the descriptions of people. Mm-hmm. And do visually impaired people or blind people really feel faces to know what people look like? And have you ever done it?
I can honestly say I don't know any visually impaired people that do that on a regular basis to know what others look like. And in almost 17 years of being blind, I don't recall ever doing that, you know, seriously. I may have done it facetiously as a joke with somebody, you know, but I don't remember ever actually doing that to discern what someone looks like, no.
Okay. This one is sort of for you specifically.
Okay.
Do you remember colors?
I do remember colors, actually. Now, as the years go by, maybe they'll fade. I don't know. But after 17 years, I do still remember. Like if my mom says, you know, it's blue. Okay, sky blue, blueberry blue, blue like the old pillows that used to be on our couch 17 years ago, blue like my old baseball uniform. Like, I remember that.
Right.
Red. Okay, brick red, barn red, Santa Claus red, fire engine red, apple red. Like, that does mean something to me. So, yeah. I remember what the rainbow looks like. So, yeah, absolutely.
So, how would someone who's blind from birth learn colors?
So that's actually a question that I asked of my teacher, the visually impaired, in high school, just out of curiosity, what she does with her students that were blind from birth. And what she explained to me, her method is to bring in something that is often associated by society with a certain color. So she said, we as a culture associate blue with cold. So she'll put an ice cube in their hand. Are ice cubes blue? No, but that's as close as you can really get. Red and orange are often associated with heat, so she'll turn on a stove and hold their hand near the burner, associating it with warmth. She'll run their hand in the grass to communicate green. Now, colors are so abstract that that's really about as close as you can get is what she explained to me, but that was her method for communicating color to someone blind from birth.
All right. Do you dream at night, and what is it like? Is this the same for those who are blind from birth?
So my dreams are really weird, and I would say dreams for any visually impaired person are really weird. When I dream at night, the dream is obviously in my perspective. So as a result, in my dream, I have vision, but I'm functioning as someone who is blind. I'm using a cane, I'm using a guide dog, I'm reading Braille, but I'm seeing at the same time because the dream is in my perspective. Now, if there are people in my dream that I knew with vision, again, they appear in my dream today as they did in 2003 or prior. If there's somebody in my dream who I have met since losing my vision, they are either a disembodied voice or they are a voice that is associated with a very distorted, blurry, vague body that doesn't really have any distinctive or identifiable features because I don't know what they look like. Now, sometimes on a subconscious level, if I meet someone, let's say now in my blind days, I meet someone named Christopher, I will think back to, okay, when I had vision, did I know someone named Christopher? And on a subconscious level, the Christopher I knew with vision, his identity will get transposed onto the new Christopher that I know now without vision. So sometimes that happens, and then when I dream about the present Christopher, if he appears or Samantha or, you know, whoever, you know, the person that I knew then with vision, their image in a distorted way will appear in my current. It's weird. It's really weird. Now, someone who's blind from birth, I'm thinking that their dreams, I don't know this for sure, but I'm thinking their dreams are going to be primarily just the disembodied voices. They obviously know what their own body feels like, but not necessarily what it looks like. So they might have the distorted, blurry, physical human body, but again, nothing identifiable. you know, but primarily just the voices I'm thinking.
Okay.
Yeah.
I wonder where this question came from. What is riding in a car like without vision?
Yeah, so that takes some getting used to, whether you're in the front seat or the back seat. I will say that when I first lost my vision 17 years ago, I would frequently get car sick and motion sickness. Again, front seat, back seat didn't matter. Because I couldn't look out the window, I didn't have that landscape as a point of reference. And so, yeah, I would frequently get car sick. As time went on, that wore off. Depending on who's driving or the terrain, it still might happen. If the road is very hilly or curvy, or if we're in stop and go traffic and the person driving has a heavy foot on the gas and the brake, sometimes I still might get car sick. But yeah, I think that is a struggle. And I'll even say, when I went to college down in Langhorne at Philadelphia Biblical University, even though it's pretty much highway to get from Boyertown, where I live, to Langhorne, if I would be on campus for 4, 6, 8 weeks at a time without coming home for a weekend, that first trip back in the car, it would be a little rough. Just because I've gone so many weeks there without being in a car, that to suddenly get back in, that hour and a half drive home from Langhorne, it was a little rough at times. So, yeah, it's a real issue. So.
All right, how about this one? When a sighted person is speaking to someone who is visually impaired or blind, is it wrong to use words like, did you see the game, see you later, or watch television?
Not at all. I use those terms. I watch more TV than I should. I say, see you later. And yes, unfortunately, I saw the Eagles game from 2 days ago that we'd all like to forget. So, yes, I use those terms. I do know some visually impaired people make a concerted effort to change their terminology and eliminate those words. They say they listen to the game, or they, you know, I'll hear you later. I just think it's awkward and clunky, and I think it draws more attention to the visual impairment than what is necessary. Some people do it, I do not. But as sighted people, if you're interacting with someone without vision, don't be afraid to use those words. There's nothing wrong with those words.
Sort of along the same lines, are there certain words or phrases that are annoying or frustrating to visually impaired people that should be avoided?
There actually are. It's the vague, nondescript words. Like if I say, where's the salt and pepper shaker? Oh, it's over there. Well, what does that mean? Like, that's very vague and nondescript. You know, have you seen my water bottle? Yep, it's over here. Okay, what does that mean? Terms like there and here are oftentimes associated with a finger point or a hand gesture, which are totally lost on the visually impaired community. You know, another one that can be frustrating is if I'm walking and someone says to me, Mark, there's a narrow opening, just walk straight. Well, straight is whatever direction I'm currently moving, and I'm going to try not to veer, but that might not be what you meant by straight. So, yeah, it's those kinds of vague and nondescript terms that you want to avoid.
Okay. How about, why do some visually impaired people wear dark-tinted glasses or sunglasses?
So, again, going back to what I said earlier, the majority of the visually impaired community has partial or limited vision. So with that partial or limited vision, they are oftentimes very sensitive to light. That the little bit of vision they have, the light comes in, it floods what vision they have, and it's overwhelming and can oftentimes even cause pain in the eyes or even severe headaches, or if I can use the term, a blinding migraine. So the tinted glasses, the sunglasses, are used in an effort to try and minimize the amount of light that does get in, because it is such a sensitive issue. Other people, you know, for people who are totally blind, sometimes, depending on the cause of their vision loss, they may have had to have their eyes removed. Like, I know some people who actually developed cancer in their eyes and they had to have their eyes removed. Whether they have glass eyes or their eyelid just gets sewn closed, either because of self-consciousness with the community, sighted community, or just knowing that that can be a disturbing image to the sighted community, they will wear the sunglasses, the tinted glasses, to try to shield that. Or even someone like myself who is blind for a long time, we might develop nystagmus, which is a fancy way of saying you lose the muscle control over your eyes. Again, same old thing with muscles. If you don't use it, you're going to lose it. And with your eye muscles, if you're not using them because you're totally blind, your eyes are going to shake and they're going to be kind of, they're not going to look normal. So sometimes people will wear the sunglasses or tinted glasses to hide that. Okay. So, yeah.
All right, so we're going to put these last two questions together because I think they're related. What do you miss the most and wish that you could see now? Mm-hmm. And what's the hardest thing you had to learn or relearn after you lost your vision?
So in terms of what I miss seeing, it's the little things. It's the faces of my family. And then, you know, the richness of colors, you know, the sunset, the sunrise, the beauty of the fall as the leaves change, and then the bursting of color when spring comes and everything's in bloom, the fresh snowfall where the sun glistens off the snow and off the icicles. It's those little things that I miss. A clear night sky in the summer when you look up and the sky is just like a bed of diamonds on a black blanket. You know, those are the little things that I miss the most. And in terms of the hardest thing to learn or relearn, hands down, Braille. Not necessarily learning the different dot formations, but training my fingers to be sensitive enough to pick them up and to be able to read it. That was brutal. I was very stubborn, and I used to fight my teacher, the visually impaired, when it came to my Braille lessons. My apologies for that, Ruth. But eventually, I came around and was cooperative, and I learned the Braille code, and I trained my fingers, and I'm glad I did it. But for a long time, it was brutal.
All right. Well, I thank you for answering some of these questions. Obviously, we did not get to nearly all of them that we thought we would, which we figured we wouldn't.
Right.
But thank you for answering this.
Of course. And just so everyone is aware, you know, it is important to ask the questions. If anyone out there does have questions for the visually impaired, I'd encourage you, find someone who's visually impaired that you're comfortable with, that is comfortable with their vision loss. Ask the questions. You know, when I lost my vision 17 years ago, I felt like part of the calling and purpose on my life from that point forward was to help educate the sighted community. And, you know, I'm trying to still do that now. But, you know, not everyone is as comfortable with their vision loss as I am, but I still encourage people to ask questions, because if you don't ask questions, you'll never know. You'll make up an answer based on assumptions, and it's probably going to be wrong. So find someone to ask. Yeah, and just so everyone's aware, we do have our monthly lunch bunch coming up January 15th at Mimo's Restaurant and Pizzeria, Sight Loss Support Group on January 22nd with me at the VRC. If you want to attend those, just call me, Mark Levengood, at 610-375-8407, extension 120. And our activity line is always available at 610-375-8407, extension 123. Again, we hope you had enjoyed the program. Have a great day. Happy 2020 to everyone, and we hope to see you in February.
Insight on BCTV is supported by the Vision Resource Center.